Hi, I'm Jim Covington, and I'd like to welcome you to this week's issue of ISBA Statehouse Review. Today is January 16, 2013, and the Illinois General Assembly is going to reconvene in about 2 weeks, and then they're going to take off and be in session about every week. I'd like to talk to you about five bills. One of them has been sent to the governor in the last General Assembly. It's House Bill 5151, and it does three things in the medical malpractice and tobacco litigation area. It first reenacts and repeals statutory provisions in the Code of Civil Procedure that have been affected by the Supreme Court's decisions in Best versus Taylor Machine Works and the LeBron medical malpractice decision. I think the intent there was to try to make the statute correctly reflect what the law is after the Supreme Court's decisions. The second thing it does, it caps all contingent attorney's fees in a medical malpractice case at 33 1/3% of all sums recovered. It repeals that sliding scale. And the third thing it does, it limits the supersedious bond requirement for all appellants collectively in a tobacco settlement case to be no more than $250 million. And that is House Bill 5151, and it has been sent to the governor. We have four bills now that I'd like to talk to you about that have been introduced, and the General Assembly will be introducing bills right and left in the next 4 to 5 weeks. The first one is House Bill 25, introduced by Representative Mary Flowers from Chicago, and House Bill 162, introduced by Representative Chapalavia from Aurora, and it makes a number of changes to the small estate affidavit. And reading between the lines here, I think you can sort of discern that one of their constituents had been the victim of a fraudulent, or what that person believed to be a false small estate affidavit, and they're trying to put much more regulations and requirements into it. It requires, for example, it requires that the affidavit state that that all these different kind of expenses have been paid instead of just funeral expenses. It makes a number of changes to surviving spouses that you've got to explain why the surviving spouse is not the affiant. If it's a medical reason, have to attach a medical report saying that's why he or she couldn't serve. If there is no minor spouse, a surviving spouse, and one or more minor children, the affiant must be a court-appointed guardian for one or more of the children. It does a number of things that has been introduced and referred to House Rules Committee for assignment later to a substantive committee. The next bill is Senate Bill 31, introduced by Senator Mike Nolan from Elgin, and this creates the Uniform Collaborative Law Act, if I got the title right, which defines and regulates the use of collaborative law in family law cases only. And that's been referred to Senate Committee on Assignments for a later assignment to a substantive committee. The third pending bill that has been filed is a resolution for a constitutional amendment. It's HJRCA1, introduced by Representative Lou Lang from Chicago, a House Democratic leader. And that is a constitutional amendment that essentially creates standing for victims to act as a party in criminal law cases. There was a similar bill that almost passed last year that has been referred to the House Rules Committee for later assignment. The fifth and final bill is Senate Bill 36, introduced by Senator Ira Silverstein from Chicago, that affects local governments and their debt collection. And it allows local governments to immobilize vehicles until the debt is paid off as part of a post-judgment collection process. There's a procedure that they have to go through that immobilization may not occur until the judgment debtor has an opportunity to appear and contest the immobilization at a citation or hearing, or if the debtor fails to appear at such a hearing, the immobilization may take place. The judgment debtor then gets a sticker on their car, they immobilize it, and then the judgment debtor must pay those costs within, I believe, 24 hours, or the vehicle may be towed and impounded, and the impounded vehicle would be then eligible for auction or public sale after 21 days if from the towing and impounding if the judgment debtor has not paid that. And that's been referred to the Senate Committee on Assignments for later assignment to a substantive committee. That's all this week, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.